having said all that, why don't you stand? Amen. It's such an incredible thing. And we're gonna finish up the In Him series tonight. Father, we thank you for the Word of God. We thank you that we can come to the Revelator of the Church, the Holy Spirit. We thank you that as we open your Word, that you will open our eyes, open our hearts, open our ears to hear, open our eyes to see. Father, you know what we need. You know the times and the seasons of this generation. And I ask, Father, that you would use me tonight and that you would assist me as I open your Word to do what you want done in this place. We pray for our youth, our children. We ask, Father, that you'd bless them and fill their hearts. And we thank you now for Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And we all said, amen. We've been studying in Him. And I am going to be starting out in the book of Colossians, and then we're going to the book of Luke. But I am going to wind up this series, and this is number six, teaching number six. If you haven't heard them, you can download them, or you can see them online, you can podcast them, or you can buy the DVDs. There's a lot of ways you can get the Word. But Luke started us out, and that blonde kid that was, he's not a kid, he's a man. He'll always be my kid. He's our youngest. Started us out with the first one on teaching in Him. We have righteousness. We are the righteousness of God in Him. And he began to share with us and teach us that not only are we positionally right with God, but that position empowers the practice of righteousness, that there's a responsibility that corresponds with the position, that we are right with God, but we can always, and we can also have the ability and the power of God to do right for God. So that word righteousness means to be right and to do right. It's a simple word, it's a Christian word, but it means that before God we've been cleansed, we have absolutely been justified just as if we never sinned. And when God looks at us, he does not see our sin or our stain or the shame of our past. We are washed by the blood of Jesus. We are completely cleansed and we are empowered by God to begin to work and do his good pleasure in our everyday, fleshing out our everyday Christianity lives. So it's be right for God, do right with God, do right for God. And so then he did part two, and he spoke about in him was life and that he is life. And then number three, I believe, was Pastor Richard Valenueva. He's our youth pastor, phenomenal teaching machine. We are blessed to have him with us in this team. He grew up in this church and his wife, Michelle. And Richard taught us that we are complete in him out of Colossians. And then I think it was number four was my husband, Jim, Pastor Jim. And he taught us about abiding in him. And that when we abide in him, when we live, stay, and dwell in his presence and in him, there are things that are unlocked in our lives and things that we can begin to move into and things we can begin to grow up as disciples. And it was an amazing word. And then number five was last week. And Dr. Paul Orgando, our amazing Iglesia La Roca pastor, and he taught on the anointing and that we are anointed in him and we are anointed by him and the anointing, what it does for us. And so we've looked at five things in him that he does for us. But tonight I wanted to look at who he is, because here's what I think. I think that we can know him as a man and see him in the flesh. Because in the New Testament, when you see Jesus, he is all God, but he's all man. Born a babe in Bethlehem, and he was very common and very ordinary. As a matter of fact, when you looked at him, you couldn't believe that this was God in the flesh. They didn't believe it. They couldn't believe it. And then he began to be anointed by the Holy Spirit in his 30th year. God spoke over him in that baptism. And then the signs and the wonders of Spirit led him into the wilderness, and he began to manifest the miracles and the signs and the wonders. And he began to teach the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of God, and he began to share. And no one had ever heard him teach like that, and no one ever seen the signs and the wonders and the miracles that he did. The blind saw. I mean, he seemed to spit at people a lot. I don't know if you've noticed that about Jesus in his healing ministry, but Donnell Guerra was here, and she taught us about how many times he actually did spit in blind eyes and make mud and things like that. He was human, very human. And if you were to look at him, he was in a common clay cup. And we see that he touched the lepers and he raised the dead. I mean, he would mess up a funeral. I mean, you couldn't take Jesus to a funeral. It was just not going to work. He was on his way to through the city of Nain, and there was a widow and her son, and her husband had died. And he just stopped the whole procession, and he just raised that young man from the dead and gave him back to his mother. I mean, who was this man? He was with his disciples, as Jim taught us, on a Wednesday night. And, you know, they're being absolutely swamped by this incredible tempest on the Sea of Galilee. And he's asleep in the stern of the boat. He's asleep back in the back of the boat. And they're all getting the water out of the boat. And they're yelling at him, "Don't you care that we're perishing?" And he is sound asleep, snoring. Well, it doesn't say he was snoring, but he could have been. He was probably exhausted. And then he just got up, spoke to the wind and the sea, and he said, "Peace, be still," and it obeyed him. He called Peter out into the deep, said, "Let your nets down." And Peter, the fisherman, said, "Oh, come on, I have already done this. This man's a carpenter, he's not a fisherman. But yet at your word, I'll do what you ask me to do." They let their nets down, and you know what happened. The nets were so full of fish that it almost swamped the boats. And he had to call John, his partner, to come over and help him. Got on his knees in that boat, and he said, "Depart from me, for I'm a sinful man." He knew that there was something about this man that was not like anybody else. And yet when you looked at him, he was ordinary. He was common. He was just somebody that you could walk right by and not see that there was anything glorious or amazing or beautiful in him. He was in the flesh, God incarnate. So I wanted tonight to look at a glimpse of something that happened in his life and something that happened with three of the disciples. Because I believe that sometimes we don't know the value of what we've got. I think sometimes we can have something so valuable and we can either take it for granted, look at it as ordinary, or not know its real value. And I think that happens to all of us. Jim and I had a home we had purchased in a beach city. And we were there, and we got it during the recession. We didn't have a home, and Jim went after it, and it was just a God gift. And we had no idea how much that house was really going to be worth. And we sold it. We made a little bit of money. Not a lot, but a little bit. We covered our losses from the recession, but if we would have waited 1 year, we would have had $1 million in our pocket. We didn't know the value of what we had. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Let me read you this little illustration, not seeing the value. A story is told of a man who loved old books. He met an acquaintance who had just thrown away a Bible that had been stored in the attic of his ancestral home for generations. I couldn't read it. The friend explained somebody named Guten something or other had printed it. "Not Gutenberg," the book lover exclaimed in horror. "Yeah, that Bible was one of the finest books ever printed. Why, a copy just sold for over $2 million. His friend was unimpressed. "Mine wouldn't have bought a dollar. Some fellow named Martin Luther had scribbled all over it in German." Didn't know what he had. In the book of Colossians, as Paul is writing, he writes in chapter 1, if you'll go there with me. And starting with verse 15, we're going to look at another "in him." The word of God says that he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created through him and for him. Verse 17, and he is before all things, and in him all things consist. In him, all things consist. We know that he's described in the book of Hebrews as the preeminent King, and that he is the Word made flesh, the begotten, the only begotten of the Father. And we've seen him in his manhood. As a matter of fact, there's a man seated at the right hand of the Father. He didn't leave his manhood. He didn't leave his image. He identified with us so that we could identify with him. And I just want to read this to you. I've read it to you before, but I read it in the Christology class that I teach, and I think it bears repeating. You want to hear this quote? It's quite interesting. It says, "Having become man, God the Son will never cease to be man. Even in heaven and through all eternity, he will be God in the flesh, albeit glorified flesh. The humanity that he has assumed on earth, he has taken to heaven. There is no longer a penalized, suffering humanity, but a human body irradiated with the glory of God. The eternal Logos will forever know in himself the joy of the redeemed as well as the triumph of the Redeemer. He will live forever in his two natures. The implications of this for our planet and people are enormous. It means that there is a human being on the throne of the universe. In the place of supreme and central significance for all creation, there is a man, a member of, and the head of the human race. Science has taught us something of the vastness of the created universe, but because of its alienation from God and its consequent deficient understanding of humankind as it should be, our society has felt shrunken and lost and insignificant in a vast cosmos. But it is in the teaching and life and redeeming work of Jesus Christ that we rediscover reconciled man's true significance and real destiny. It is not into the angelic race that God was born, but into the people of this inconspicuous planet. It's not an angelic nature that he now inhabits and lives through at the Father's right hand, but a human one. Go to the spiritual heart of this created universe, and there you will find a man. Go to the place where angels bow who never fell, and you will find a man. Go to the very center of the manifested glory of the invisible God, and you will find a man. True human nature, one of your own race, mediating the glory of God." We know him in the New Testament, but have we seen him? Have we seen him? Now, I know I'm doing a lot of reading tonight. Are you okay? Because I think it bears part of this teaching is the power of visual communication. What we see has a profound effect on what we do, how we feel, and who we are. Through experience and experimentation, we continually increase our understanding of the visual world and how we are influenced by it. The psychologist Albert Mirambai demonstrated that 93% of communication is nonverbal. Research at 3M Corporation concluded that we process visuals 60,000 times faster than text. We process visuals 60,000 times faster than text. So what we see is a more powerful tool to teach us than what we read or what we hear. Now, having said that, I've said two things. I've said, I don't think sometimes we know the value of what we have. And the second thing is that we are human. We're in a three-dimensional world, time, substance, space. We see in a linear world of three dimensions. God is in the invisible. We are in the visible realm. And God knows us, and he knows us so well. And he knows that there are things that need to happen so that we can see. And I want to talk tonight about in him all things consist. And I want to speak tonight about just a glimpse of his glory, an event that happened. It's called the Transfiguration. It's in the book of Matthew, chapter 17. It's in the book of Mark, chapter 9, and it's in the book of Luke, chapter 9. And I want to look at a glimpse of what happened and that event when God took, when the Word made flesh, the only begotten of the Father, took his three inner group. He took Peter and their brothers, James and John, and he took them up to go and pray with him. But something very significant and very supernatural happened, and they got a glimpse of the glory of the King. Not the flesh, Not the natural, not the three-dimensional, but something happened and it changed them forever. Now, there's a reason why God put this in the Word of God in three of the Gospels. Because if you and I can ask the Holy Spirit to help us visualize what happened and what went on, I believe the Holy Spirit can take the Word of God and he can begin to paint with his brushstrokes in our spirit images and pictures and illustrations so that you and I can begin to see the King like we've never seen him before. And he gets bigger in us because in him, all things consist. And how big is God in me when I see in the visual the giants in the land, the problems, the challenges, the heartache, the brokenness? You see, I can look at the visual of the natural world. We learn 60,000 times faster by what we see. Or I can learn to see and look at Jesus in the invisible world and begin to see him as he is. And that picture gets big on the inside of me. And like Caleb and Joshua, when they see a giant, God was the giant on the inside of them, not the giant looking at them to take them out. And I believe that's what God wants for us. So let's go to Luke chapter 9. Let's just go on a little journey. Holy Spirit, we just ask you to paint with your marvelous, incredible imagination this transfiguration, because we cannot possibly understand this. Now, John wrote about it and Peter wrote about it. It so affected them that they wrote about it in their John wrote about it in his gospel and in his letters, and Peter wrote about it in his letter. James, the brother of John, didn't get a chance. We don't have an epistle from him that is in the canon or the 66 books of the Bible. So he was martyred before he had a chance to write. But this affected them and changed their lives. And the word metamorphosis, let me just say what it means. It means to be transfigured. And the Greek word is metamorpho. And you don't speak it, and I don't either, but let's look at what it means. It means to transform literally or figuratively, to metamorphize or to change. The word is a verb that means to change into another form. It also means to change the outside to match the inside. In the case of the transfiguration of Jesus, God displayed the Shekinah glory of the incarnate Son. The voice of God attesting to the truth that Jesus was his Son was the second time that God's voice was heard. The first was at his baptism. Like I said, it's recorded three times in the gospel. So let's read in Luke chapter 9, and we're going to read from verses 27 to 36. Then we'll look at it, all right? We'll take it apart. What does this mean to us today? Luke chapter 9, verse 27. And this is Jesus speaking to his disciples, but I tell you truly, there are some standing here who shall not taste death till they see the kingdom of God. He came preaching and teaching the kingdom. And now he's saying that you're not going to taste death until you see it. Now it came to pass about 8 days after these sayings that he took Peter, John, and James and went up on the mountain to pray. As he prayed, the appearance of his face was altered and his robe became white and glistening. And behold, two men talked with him who were Moses and Elijah, who appeared in glory and spoke of his decease, which he was about to accomplish in Jerusalem. But Peter and those with him were heavy with sleep. And when they were fully awake, they saw his glory and the two men who stood with him. And then it happened, as they were parting from him, the two men were parting from him, that Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it's good for us to be here, and let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. Don't you love Peter? While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud saying, "This is my beloved Son. Hear him." And when the voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone, but they kept quiet and told no one in those days any of the things that they had seen. And in the book of Matthew and in the book of Mark, Jesus tells them, "Don't tell anyone what you have seen until after I have raised from the dead." Now, he is on his way to Jerusalem to the cross. So let's just think about what happened here. His inner circle of friends, Peter, James, the brothers, and John, called Sons of Thunder. They went up to a mountain with him. We believe it's Mount Tabor. And they went up there because he wanted to pray. And as he is praying, he's wearing his prayer shawl and he's praying, they fall asleep. They're exhausted and they are out. And as he is praying, there is something that is happening to him. He is not just praying like they've seen him pray. They're asleep. They don't know what's going on, but he's transforming. He is transfiguring. His face is altered. His clothes are changed. Everything is different. And then out of nowhere, I mean, just think about this. Out of space walks in Moses and Elijah. Now, I don't know about you, but that would have blown me away. Think about it. What right now, if somebody just out of thin air just appeared to us and started talking, and we recognized them as Moses the lawgiver, and we could tell it was Moses, they knew it was Moses, and Elijah the prophet. And here is Jesus, and he is being transfigured before them. Now, I have a picture of an artist's rendering of what it might have looked like. But it says that his clothes changed. His face was altered. Something was happening on the inside of him. Now, I've read this many times to this church, so I'm probably not going to read it, but there's an illustration of what happened, and it's written out, and it's just brilliant how the authors wrote this. But I think it kind of came down like this. There he is praying, and all of a sudden, the glory, the majesty, the splendor of who he is. He is the Yahweh of the Old Testament. He is the burning bush God. He's the cloud by day. He's the pillar by night. He is God, the Word, God the Son. He is the one that I read to you in Colossians, that all things were made by him, and all things were made through him. And without him, nothing was made that was made. And that in him, all things consist. Hebrews says he holds all things together by the word of his power. Who is he? I believe as he just began to pray, that they began to see the glory of his majesty. Now, my husband has introduced the word glory to us. It's a Greek word named doxa. And it means many, many things. There's many facets of definition. And I love Jim's definition of God's manifested goodness. But there's also other definitions of glory. And this one isn't just the goodness of God manifesting. This is the majesty, the splendor, the divine, the power of the Godhead, the very power that spoke the world into existence. In Psalm 33, it says he opened his mouth and he breathed out the hosts of heaven, all the angelic armies. He created the cherubim and the seraphim. He created the burning ones. He made the watchers. He made the hosts of angelic beings. He's made the cosmos and the universe. And his glory, his majesty, his splendor, his power, his divinity was beginning to change and alter his physical form. And it was as if there were molten diamonds just emanating. The light was beginning to emanate from his core and out of his hands. Rays of majesty and splendor and power were coming. And out of his face, which was altered completely, they couldn't even look at it. And he turned to look at his disciples, and his eyes were like lasers beaming and going to the very core of these disciples. This is God. The word manifest. Who is he that he would become a man, identify with you and I? The word that created everything. The angels knew him in glory, but they'd never seen him as a baby. The angels bowed to him and did his bidding in the third heaven, but to see him tired, hungry, tempted by the one that has rebelled and fallen, a created being that he made, they'd never seen. And then to see him on the road to Calvary, the God of the universe, his beard being pulled out, spit upon, beaten beyond recognition, and then laying down on a cross and giving his life up when he said, no man takes my life from me. I lay it down and I have authority to pick it up. Listen, you and I cannot go down into the depths of Sheol, the depths of hell, and pick the keys of death and hell. We can't get there. We can only die. We cannot resurrect. You ever seen anybody come back from the grave on their own at a funeral? It doesn't happen, does it? This is God. My point is, in him all things consist. And I know him, and I can be so casual with who he is. And I believe that God wants us to shake ourselves and understand the value of this God and who he really is. I get the privilege of teaching the doctrine of angels this semester to our class, and I don't have a picture up, but we've been looking at the description of the hierarchy of the council and of the hosts of heaven. And the seraphim are burning ones and fiery ones and so splendid and so glorious. And the cherubim are four-faced, four-dimensional beings that have wheels within wheels and eyes within eyes and wings. And I mean, you can't imagine what they look like or what they are. And these are beings that he made. He made them. He spoke them into existence. He created the universe that we see, the material universe. There are over 200 billion stars in our galaxy of the Milky Way. The Hubble telescope tells us that there are over 200 billion galaxies that they've discovered. We can't even imagine the expanse of this space that he has breathed into existence. And yet, he became a man and dwelt among us. The glory of the only begotten of the Father. And there they are, sound asleep. Something's happening. There's a blinding light that wakes them up. They look and they see, and out of thin air, they see the prophet Elijah, and they see the lawgiver Moses. And they are talking to Jesus about what is going to happen in Jerusalem. And Peter rubs his eyes and wakes up and says, Lord, it's good, it's good, this is good, this is so good. And then he sees that Moses and Elijah are leaving. They just got here. Wait. It's good. I'll build three tabernacles. I'll build a tent for you, Moses. I'll build one for you, Elijah. And Jesus will build one for you. And then this is what happens. Luke chapter 9. Verse 33 said, then it happened as they were parting from him, that Peter said to Jesus, Master, it's good for us. I just said that. Verse 34. While he was saying this, a cloud came and overshadowed them, and they were fearful as they entered the cloud. And a voice came out of the cloud, and it said, this is my beloved Son. Hear him. When the voice had ceased, Jesus was found alone. There was no one else. Let me read this to you. While Peter was speaking, a dark cloud appeared, the Shekinah glory of Sinai casting a shadow over them, encasing them in an atmosphere so heavy they could barely breathe. Dangerous energy surrounded the men, crackling and sparkling and flashing as a voice like thunder flowed from the cloud. At the sound of his voice, they fell, crushed to the dust of the earth. It boomed in their hearts, causing terror and a death-chilling fear to shake their very bones. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him. And looking around, they suddenly no longer saw anyone except Jesus only. Church, I don't think we have a clue of who we have. I don't think we have a clue. I think that there is so much adventure ahead of us. You think this is cool, Earth? Wait till you get to heaven. We haven't seen anything yet. But I believe, and this is why I'm spending so much time on this. I believe that God wants us to see. I believe the Holy Spirit wants to paint a picture. He wants to take a divine brush, and he wants to begin to paint the form and the glory and the beauty of the Master inside of our hearts so that we can be strong and we can grow. And I want to talk to you tonight as in these last 10 minutes. Are you all right with me? And if you want to know what he looks like, and if you want to do this, this is what I've done, is I've read the book of Revelation, I don't know how many times, but I love to hang out in Revelation 4 and 5 because it's a picture of the throne. And I love to read Ezekiel because Ezekiel saw the cherubim, he saw the creatures, he saw them, and I love to see what he saw. And I read about Daniel, and I read about the supernatural, and I read these things, and I say, Holy Spirit, I can't even imagine to envision these things because I'm not very creative and I don't understand. And I believe that the Holy Spirit wants us to see these things. He doesn't want us to intrude on those things that are not ours to know. He's very clear about that. But I do believe he wants us to intrude on the majesty and the glory and the significance of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. I believe he wants the church to see him, to know him, to love him, and to absolutely let him be the fuel and the igniter of the passion that we need to carry in this generation to believe him for the impossible and to do what we've never done, go where we've never gone, say what we've never said, and see what we have never seen. I believe he wants us to see him very clearly. So having said that, I want you to understand that as we look at this, there's just three little things tonight we're going to look at. That what has this got to do with us, this vision? What has this got to do? And I want to look at three things, how this transfiguration can change our lives and it can affect my life today in the 21st century as I look back to the Word and as the Holy Spirit begins to minister to me. And the Word is alive and it's sharp and it's powerful. It's alive. It's not just a word. It is spirit. Jesus said, my words are life and they are spirit. And if you read it and you speak it and you look into it and you ask the Holy Spirit to help you as you read the Word of God, you are in for the greatest adventure of your life as he begins to open up your hearts and begins to teach you and show you the things in the Word of God. So go with hunger to the Word and ask the Spirit, the Revelator. He's there. He's your teacher. Jesus said, I'm sending him to you. And he's going to take of that which belongs to me and he's going to give it to you. And if we'll just be hungry children, dependent and humble, I believe the Holy Spirit wants to teach us things that'll change our lives and change our generation. Amen? So three things. 2 Corinthians, verse 1, 19 through 21. And I'm going to say this, number one. I'm lost in my notes here. Let me see where I'm at. I stapled some stuff together, and it's all messed up. Here it is. So what does that mean for me today? And I just want to say this. Listen to what John wrote. John 21, 25. I love this verse. He says, and there are also many other things that Jesus did, which if they were written one by one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that would be written. That's what John wrote. The last verse of his gospel. He said, if we wrote everything down that he did, there wouldn't be enough space on the planet to house the books. You think we can learn some things about him in the 21st century? Really? Or do you think we know it all? We haven't even scratched the surface. So number one, what does this mean to me today? Well, in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18, it says, so all of us who have had that veil removed can see and reflect the glory of the Lord. And this is a New Living Translation. And the Lord, who is the Spirit, makes us more and more like Him as we are changed into His glorious image. Now in the New King James, it says, as we behold Him as in a mirror, we are changed. As we look into this mirror, the mirror reflects back to us, and we are changed from glory to glory into the image of Jesus Christ. What does that mean? That means that His glory, His splendor, His majesty, His goodness, His temperament, His personality, His power, His majesty, all of these things that He is, He wants to give to His church, which is His body on the earth. He's the head, we're the body. In Him all things consist. And He is head over all things, and He's given Himself to the church. And the fullness of the Godhead dwells in Him. So as we dwell in Him, God downloads into us a change and a supernatural glory, a goodness and a beauty that we could never be without Him. And it's called a reflection. So what do we do? Three things. A vision of His glory. I believe that when I see Him, when I meditate upon Him as God, I believe that it inflames my love and it ignites my fear of the Lord. It inflames my love and it ignites my fear. You know, Jesus, when He wrote to the churches in Ephesus in Revelation, He said, listen, you're busy. You've got all kinds of things going on for you. You've tested the apostles. I'm proud of you. You've done a good job, but I have this against you. You've left your first love. You used to be a passionate church for me, but you got so busy with the ministry, you forgot why you were ministering. And it's so easy to do as church people. You get in the church bubble, and you just go through the motions, and yet there's no spark anymore, and there's no power anymore, and there's no passion anymore. And God says, I'm jealous over you. I want you to love me, and I want you to fall in love with me like I love you, and I want that love to change you so that you don't obey me because you have to. You obey me because you are so passionate for me that you wouldn't dare want to displease me in any way. It's not a have to, it's a get to love. But if we don't know Him, it becomes a have to. And we go through the motions of taking this marriage relationship for granted. And we exist with Him and the Holy Spirit, but the passion's gone. And I believe God wants to ignite our passion, ignite our love. It says in 1 John chapter 4, verse 10, this is real love. Not that we loved God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as a sacrifice to take away our sin. This is love. This is it. You want to know what it is? This is it. Not that we loved Him, but He loved us and sent the second person of the Godhead who created everything. Sent Him into the womb of a virgin. He took on flesh and He became the last Adam and He identified with us. He became man so that we could become sons and daughters of God. That's real love. And that should impassion my motivation for why I come to church, why I want to witness to my neighbors, why I want to be kind to my family, why I want to be a good person on the job, why I want to reveal the goodness, the manifested goodness, the glory of God in my everyday life, because this works out in our everyday lives, and it starts in our homes where it's hard to do it and easy to take each other for granted. It impassions my love. It ignites my fear. John Bevere said that the love of God draws me, but the fear of God keeps me. Good statement. The love of God draws me. It's the goodness of God that leads me to repentance. I already know I'm screwing up, but when I know He loves me and He's not mad at me, He's telling me to come and get right and get clean, then I can run to Him like a child and say, okay, help me. That's what happened in my life. It was His goodness that brought me back to God. It wasn't the judgment. It was the goodness. But the fear of the Lord keeps me. Now that fear is an interesting thing. It says the fear of the Lord in the book of Proverbs chapter 9. I believe it's verse 8. I'm not sure about the address. But it says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And in chapter 8 of Proverbs, it says the fear of the Lord is to hate evil. So if I'm to fear God, then I'm to hate evil. And it's the very beginning of wisdom, which tells me that anything in my life that I'm listening to or learning from that is not grounded in the fear of God as its foundation is worldly wisdom and not godly wisdom, and it's corrupted and it's going to go south on me. Are you hearing what I'm saying? I just said a profound thing. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. So if whoever is teaching you doesn't have the fear of God at the center and the foundation of that knowledge, is that knowledge earthly or is that knowledge godly? Right? See, God wants us to be successful. The fear of the Lord will keep me. I had a dad and he had a belt. I was born in 1950. That was back in the days when you could beat your kids and you didn't lose them. My dad beat me. He beat me. He took his belt out. He didn't have a little twig from a tree. He beat the poop out of me. I was a hard girl to raise. Can't imagine that you would even question that. I mean, I know I'm wonderful, but a little rebellious. And I was on this kick in seventh grade about not eating so I could be skinny and I could absolutely lose some weight. And he noticed that I wasn't eating anymore. And I was on my way to probably being anorexic. We didn't even know what that was in the 50s. You know, who knew? But my dad got so mad at me and took his belt out and said, I'm going to beat you if you don't eat that dinner your mother's cooked. I was more afraid of him and the belt than I was wanting to lose weight and be skinny. Are you hearing what I'm saying? That fear kept me. It kept me. The fear of the Lord will keep us. The love of God will draw us. But we need to be kept. We need to be afraid. We need to not want to blow it. Not want to mess him up. Not want to embarrass him. Not embarrass the family. Number two, when I see a vision of him like they saw of him, they heard about the cross. So the glory of the cross, they were talking about what was going to happen in Jerusalem. And a vision of the cross is going to fuel my faith. When Moses said to him, and when Elijah talked to him, we are looking at the lawgiver Moses, and we are looking at Elijah the prophet. Now, there are over 366 prophecies in the Word of God about Jesus. 366. In the Old Testament, there is over 48 prophecies just of his birth, not including what happened at his crucifixion. The statistics of that ever happening is impossible. And here comes Elijah the prophet, and here comes Moses the lawgiver, and they're talking about the crucifixion, and they're talking about his demise in Jerusalem. So what has that got to do with anything? Well, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, I said, I believe that a vision of the cross, when I see him and I know who he is and what he's done and how he laid his life down for me, that it fuels my faith. That it fuels my faith. That when a giant is in front of me, when an impossibility is staring at me, when a broken heart is crying out to me, when impossible situations are my temperament or my personality, or there's something in my life that God's dealing with and I just can't seem to get it right. Have you ever been there? And you're disappointed in yourself? Sometimes we can be our worst enemies. We think there's never going to be a change. And then when your family looks at you and says, you'll never change. Oh, God, thanks for all the faith. But you see, when you begin to see him, and you begin to look at him, then when you look off to those children that aren't behaving, or you look over to that marriage that is on the rocks, or you look at that job that just is not bringing you enough money, or you look at your age and you think, it's too late for me. I'll never play catch up. God's the God of catch up. God's the God of restoration. All of a sudden, then what happens is faith begins to rise in your heart because the God inside of you is bigger than the giant that is roaring at your life. When we see him as he is. And in 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians, and I know I've used this so many times, but let's look at another in him. In 2 Corinthians 1, 19 through 21. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by us, by me, Silvanus and Timothy, Paul's writing this, was not yes and no, but in him was yes for all the promises of God in him. Are yes, and in him, amen, to the glory of God through us. What is God saying? God is saying, listen, The promises of God were purchased by the life that was in that blood that paid the price for you and set you free. He had to come as the last Adam and identify with you so he could be your kinsman redeemer. He had to be human and walk through every temptation and not blow it so that he would be qualified to be the spotless, innocent Lamb of God when he laid his life down. If he was not qualified, the sacrifice could not have been received. That's why God never used human sacrifice, because the life of the flesh is in the blood, and humans have tainted, guilty flesh blood. We are born into a guilt situation. Animals are more innocent than we are because creation was afflicted because of us, because Adam had dominion. They had no choice in the fall. And all that blood could do, the blood of bulls and goats, could only keep us close so that God could be near us, but not in us. So he redeemed us, identification. Then he reconciled us. That means he brought us back to the Father. He grabbed us by the hand and said, I'm your substitution. My blood has paid for everything. And my blood has paid for every promise my Father has in the Word of God for your life, for healing, for prosperity, for everything that you have need of in this life. That's why he said, why are you worried? Why do you worry? Your Father knows you need these things. John wrote, oh, beloved, I wish you would prosper and be in good health even as your soul prospers. The will of God is not for you to be broke and sick and miserable. The will of God is for us to be sons and daughters of God and understand who he is and who we are in him and begin to lay hold of our salvation and to live up to the privilege that we have in those promises. I believe a vision of the cross fuels our faith. This is the last one, and I'll quit. I've spit all over you. You okay with me? A vision. First, it was a vision of his glory. My goodness. Nights inflames my love, and it ignites my fear. It keeps me, and it draws me. Then it was a vision of the cross, which fuels my faith. Oh, my gosh, he's paid for it. It's mine. And the last one. Because Peter writes about this. And in 2 Peter, Peter writes of this event. It's a vision of his coming. It keeps me focused. Listen, the early church believed he was coming again. It's been 2,000 years, and I know the church is weary of hearing this. But if I begin to live as if he's coming today, it is a life-changing way to live. It keeps my life focused on what's real and what isn't, what's important and what is not important. The distractions and the lies and the deceptions of this age that want to creep into my heart and my life and choke the word of God and cause me not to be fruitful as a believer. God says, if you will stay focused, if you'll keep your eyes on me, there in Hebrews chapter 12, he said, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. We don't see it now, but we see Jesus in Hebrews chapter 2. Listen, when I focus my eyes on him, and not just the crucified rabbi on that cross, but the resurrected living King of glory that is seated at the right hand of the Father that is coming again. That's the Jesus I'm looking at. That's the one my eyes are on. That's the one to whom absolutely nothing is impossible except his lying or failing on my behalf. He cannot lie. Oh. Peter writes in 2 Peter 1, verse 16, for we did not follow cunningly devised fables when we made known to you the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of his majesty. They saw him turn inside out. They saw the rays of light. They saw the power and the divinity of God himself on that mountain. They saw it. It changed them. We were eyewitnesses of his majesty, for he received from God the Father honor and glory when such a voice came to him from the excellent glory. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. And we heard this voice, which came from heaven when we were with him on the holy mountain. And so we have the prophetic word confirmed, which you do well to heed as light that shines in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. A vision of his coming will keep me focused. Peter goes on to write about the second coming of the Lord, how he's coming, what's going to happen. And church, I believe he wants us to keep our eyes up and opened and alert. How is he coming? As he appeared on the mountain with power and with glory. Matthew 24:30. The sign of the Son of Man will appear in heaven, and then all the tribes of the earth will mourn, and they will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds with power and great glory. He'll come in the clouds. Revelation 1:7. Behold, he's coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, and those who pierced him and all the tribes of the earth will mourn over him. He's coming. Who will meet him? I love this. Those who Moses represented, the dead in Christ, and those who Elijah represented, the translated. There'll be a generation that will be translated up. There'll be a generation that is asleep and will awaken to be absent from the bodies, to be present with the Lord, and they'll be clothed with brand new bodies that look just like his. He is coming again. He's settling the score. He's going to deal with evil once and for all. The sky is going to roll up like a scroll. We're going to get a brand new planet. There will be no more evil, and the Lamb and God the Father will live with mankind, and you and I be in eternity with the amazing King. Joint heirs, ruling and reigning with him. There, if you have a depressed day about getting old, let me tell you something. That's all you got to fix your mind on, is start thinking about heaven and what's going to happen. All of a sudden, this world gets real dim and real silly. Listen, they had a glimpse of his glory. They had a glimpse of his majesty and his glory. Changed them. They had a glimpse of the cross that changed them. They had a glimpse of his coming. Peter writes about it. You and I are in the 21st century. I believe God wants us to know all the things that he's done for us are incredible. In him. In him we're righteous. In him we're sanctified. In him we're anointed. In him we can abide and live and dwell and have our being. In him he will perfect that which concerns us. He is the author. He is the finisher of our faith. He is the King of kings. He is the royal God. He is the Father eternal. He is the everlasting. Isaiah called him the everlasting Father. Have you ever thought of Jesus as a father? We think of the Father as a father, but Isaiah said he's the everlasting Father. Oh, what's that? Let me tell you. He's amazing. There's nothing he won't do and can't do except lie. So church, let's settle in him. Let's let him impassion our love, ignite our fear. Let's let him fuel our faith. And let's let him cause us to focus on what we do with our lives and live every day as if he's coming back. I hope you got something out of the In Him series. In him. Tonight, we have a few minutes left, and I don't know you, and you've been so good as this old woman is up here huffing and puffing and screaming and spitting everywhere. Oh, gosh, I just can't stand the way I do that. I wish I would calm down. I seem to be more excited as I get older. Isn't that crazy? It's like, can't you just settle down? Thank you for tolerating me. But you're here tonight by divine appointment. You don't have tomorrow, but you have right now, tonight. He made you. He formed you in your mother's womb. No matter how you came into this earth, God brought you here. He didn't make you for hell. He made you for heaven. He didn't make you to be miserable. He made you to rejoice, to actually enjoy life and to love him and know him. But that's going to take something on your part, because he's done everything he can do. He's come to earth. He was born through the womb of a virgin. He walked the human experience and was tested and tempted and tried, and he was qualified to be the Lamb of God. He went to Calvary's cross for you and I. He took our place. He was our substitute. He laid his life down, and then he raised his life up. The Father raised him up after 3 days. He is alive. He's not dead. And he is seated at the right hand of the Father. He sent back the Holy Spirit to the church so that we could have a comforter and a teacher and a helper, the Holy Spirit. He's given us all these things, but there's one thing we have to do. We have to receive the gift. He's a gentleman. God will never force himself on any of us because this thing is about personal choice. It's about love. It's about you choosing him like he wants to choose you. But you see, he won't choose you if you reject him. He can't because you've got free will. So let me ask you this. What have you done with your heart and with Jesus Christ? Have you given him your heart? It says that if you believe in your heart that Jesus Christ is Lord and that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. If you believe in your heart and you confess with your mouth, but what does that mean? It means that when you hear the gospel, what you heard tonight, something on the inside of you knows it's true. You know you need a Savior, that you can't save yourself. But you see, God has done all he can do. Now you've got to say yes to him and you've got to surrender your heart and your life to him, letting him be your Savior and letting him be your Lord. And if you have never surrendered your heart and life to him and let him be your Savior and your Lord, then you're not born again. And God forbid if you were to walk out those doors tonight and you were to die, you would not make it to heaven. You would be in hell, but God didn't bring you here to die. He brought you here to live. So where are you tonight? I just like every head bowed and every eye closed for just a moment. I'm going to give you just a little gift of privacy because this is between you and God. If you were to die tonight, would you go to heaven? Or would you go to hell? If you said, I hope I'd go to heaven, then you aren't ready. You can't hope your way into heaven. You can't behave your way into heaven. You can only receive the gift of salvation through Jesus Christ by accepting him and asking him to be your Savior and your Lord. So if you've been running from God instead of to God, I'm talking to you. Maybe you said yes to Jesus like I did as a child, but you've drifted so far away from him and you know you need to get right with him. God brought you here tonight to get right. Maybe you're a good person, better than I'll ever dream of being. I was such a screw up. But you know, your goodness doesn't get you to heaven. It's not a behavior modification program. This is a relationship with the living God through his son, Jesus Christ. No matter how much you've gone to church, it won't get you to heaven. Only receiving Jesus as Savior and Lord by asking him into your life and letting him be Savior and Lord, letting him fill you and letting him help you work out the rest of your life with him. So all over this auditorium, if you need to get right with God tonight, I want you to raise your hand in just a minute. We'll do it all together. If you've been running from God instead of to God, I want you to, tonight is your night. That's why God brought you here. If you're good and you've been better than I've ever dreamed of being, but you've never surrendered your life, I'm talking to you. So I'm going to just do this. I'm just going to count to three. I'm just going to say one, two, three with our heads bowed. If you need to get right with God tonight, I just want you to lift your hand and I'll see it. Are you ready? One, two, three. Let me see your hands if you need to get right with God. Raise them high so I can see them. I see that hand. I'm asking that your heads be bowed, your eyes closed. Let's give people a moment of privacy between God and them. I know there's at least five of you in this building tonight. I see one hand. Am I missing anybody else? I see that hand. I see that hand. There's three. There's two more. I know that the Holy Spirit told me there are five. There's probably more than that. Where is it? Where's that other hand? Where's that hand? Wave at me. Oh, there you are. Four and five. There's another one. There's six. Let me see anybody else. Who needs to get right with God? God's speaking to your heart. I'm not going to shut up until you raise your hand because you don't have tomorrow, but you've got right now. He's the only one that can fix you. He's the only one. There's another hand. Don't worry about letting him down. I see that hand. You can't let him down. He's the only one that can fix you and help you be what you're supposed to be. All right, I counted at least seven. Let's do this because of the time. Let's just stand up. You've been sitting long enough, and now with hearts and eyes wide open, if you raise your hand, this is what I need you to do. I need you to slip out of your seat and just join me right here at this altar, because you don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by praying a prayer, and we're going to pray with you right now. We're just going to pray. You're going to change destinies tonight. He said, if you confess me before men, I'll confess you before my Father. In this happy, in this safe place, just come down. Don't be embarrassed. Nobody cares. Nobody cares. Good Lord, I've been spitting all over you and sweating. Nobody cares. Just quickly come. Just quickly come. Quickly come. Don't stay back. If you raised your hand, just come. Just quickly come. Quickly come. Let's get right with God tonight. I count at least seven hands that went up. Where are you? You don't get saved by raising your hands. You get saved by saying yes to Jesus. You can't walk down this aisle. How can you walk out those doors and live for God? We'll wait just another moment. I used to be so afraid I'd disappoint God and I'd let him down because I was such a screw up. I was such a rebellious girl. I was afraid to get right with God because I'd let him down. Nobody told me that you can't let him down. That when you really say yes to him, he comes inside of you and he changes you from the inside out. Like he was transfigured, you will be transfigured from the inside out. Is there anybody else? Quickly, I'm going to let him sing one more time. We're late. We're 5 minutes over tonight. Can we give five more? Can we give 60 seconds more? I'm just going to give you another moment to come. Another moment to come. God's knocking on the door of your heart. Don't miss this. Nobody can make you. This is a free will choice. Okay. Well, look up at me, you little darlings. That's you guys. Hello? Okay, you're not going to a funeral. You're going to a birthday party. It's yours. And you've got angels that are absolutely having a party with you right now. Just in heaven, having a party. This is Pastor Joel. He's going to take you, and we're going to pray with you in there privately, okay? So you just make a left turn. Let's just go and pray.